Philip Thompson. I work at DataStax in our Cassandra test department, and I'm here to talk to you about testing Cassandra with Jepsen as a service. So how does the open source Apache Cassandra project test currently? So there are two main test suites we use right now to ensure the quality of Apache Cassandra. One are our unit tests. These live in the Apache Cassandra source tree. When you check out Apache Cassandra, just run and test. It's going to run, we have about 1,000 JUnit tests that, like any good unit test, test small isolated modules of the code to ensure their functionality. Now, unfortunately, this isn't good enough in any way to test a distributed system. So we have another test suite, our distributed tests, Cassandra D-Test. These are Python-based tests that are built on top of CCM, the Cassandra Cluster Manager. This is a tool written by a Apache Cassandra PMC member, Sylvain Lebrun, and it allows you to run a Cassandra cluster in a degenerate case locally on your laptop. So it will spin up multiple JVMs all on your local machine, and it allows you to simulate a real cluster, which we use for testing, but some developers use for becoming familiar with Cassandra. So that isn't going to let us simulate actual resource contention of disks or CPU, since we have 3 or 4 or 5 JVMs all on one box, which doesn't represent a real cluster at all, but it is going to let us test features from a user's perspective. We can run a repair and see that the state on disk changes as we expect, or we can issue queries at quorum with one node down and make sure that those queries still go through. Now, is this perfect testing? No. The list of problems run off the page. There are so many things we can't do in our existing test frameworks over in open source. We're not covering duration. So does Cassandra work if you keep it up for 2 weeks straight? Well, we know that because it does in production, but we don't have any tests on release that prove that. Large clusters, does Cassandra work at 1,000 nodes? Well, luckily, users have proven that, but the open source project has no tests that assert that's true. How dense can a Cassandra node get comfortably? Is a patch going to go in that reduces that from 20 terabytes to 15 terabytes? Well, that's not something we end up catching because our unit tests and our D tests don't prove that. The list goes on. You know, how we do with degraded network performance, how we handle arbitrary failure cases, whether we're actually meeting the linearizability contracts of our lightweight transactions, et cetera, et cetera. So how are we going to handle those problems? So I'm here to talk about Jepsen. And I'm sure all of you are at least somewhat familiar with Jepsen, or else you wouldn't have come to this talk. Now, Call Me Maybe is a blog series written by Afir, whose real name is Kyle Kingsbury. And it's a blog about testing distributed systems. So Kyle has done work testing things like React, Basho, Mongo, Cassandra, Kubernetes, Mesosphere. And what he's found is essentially every distributed system on the market has correctness bugs. It has problems meeting the guarantees that those databases or those systems assert. So Cassandra was last tested by Kyle 2 or 3 years ago on the Cassandra 2.0.0 release about our brand new lightweight transactions. And we didn't do so well then, but it's been several years since then. And last year, there was a very good talk by Joel Knighton on the Jepsen testing we've been doing, where we are now testing using the Jepsen framework on new Apache Cassandra releases, and we're doing much better. We have a green test board there. So Call Me Maybe is built on top of these Jepsen tests. And these are the tests that Kyle's written that assert invariance of distributed systems. Those are built on top of a library of the same name, Jepsen. It's a closure library, which provides tools to test distributed systems. So to get into the meat of the Jepsen testing model, what is a Jepsen test, and why are these so good at catching bugs in these distributed systems that have big companies behind them, that have dozens of engineers that work very hard to make sure these bugs don't get in and are happening anyway? So these are non-deterministic tests. They have random failure injection. So you're going to be setting up your distributed system. In this case, I'm just going to be talking about Cassandra moving forward. So you're going to be setting up Cassandra, and you're going to be injecting failure. So you're going to have nodes drop. You're going to have network latency suddenly show up. You're going to have disks lost. And it's testing that entire time that invariants are maintained. So what does that mean? That's things like if a transaction went through and you got an ACK back that there is new data on the system, that later reads all show that that's the case. That's testing that if you write a quorum, later any single read a quorum is going to have that up-to-date data. It's saying that our consistency guarantees are true and hold no matter what. So why are these tests so good? And it's with this random failure injection that they are catching bugs that normal test suites are missing. In our D tests and our unit tests, and in most normal tests, you perform a series of actions and then you check the state of your system. And what that is proving is that at the end of a set of actions, that your system is in a valid and legal state. But you haven't proven anything about that entire time continuum, and that's something Jepsen is able to do. So I've stolen this slide from Joel Knighton's talk last year. And again, Jepsen is a closure library, and thus the colon prefix is something that comes from closure. And so I'm going to talk about the attributes of a Jepsen test. So a Jepsen test has a name. It has a system called an OS. And that is how you set up the machines, the hosts that your Cassandra nodes are going to run on. So that is, starting up your Docker container or imaging your virtual machine or launching an EC2 instance. That's what that OS system does. You have something called the DB, and that is explaining to Jepsen how your database works, because Jepsen is a general framework, and it works with essentially any system. It's very pluggable. So it's teaching it how to configure Cassandra. That is, here's the cassandra.yaml, and here is bin/cassandra to start Cassandra, and it's a Java process, so here's the JVM options you'll need to set. And those are all going in a DB. In client, we have the actual interactions with the DB. So that is plugging in DataStax's Java driver and explaining to Jepsen how to issue queries and what a transaction looks like. Then we get in the actual meat of the testing. We have what's called a generator, and these are our instructions on how to interact. So this is telling the Jepsen test, hey, I want you to stress the cluster with writes, or I want you to issue lightweight transactions that look like this. It is giving it the actual instructions on what to do. These are the features you're testing. The power of the Jepsen tests are now going to come from the conductors and the checkers. So the conductors and pairing with the nemeses are the same system, but nemeses exclusively deal with failure injection, and these are things that interact with the environment. So a conductor will do something like bootstrap a new node into your cluster while it's being tested. It'll do something like run repair on your cluster while it's being tested. And that lets us check that all of our features work even if you're using them all at once, which is something that's going to happen in a genuine production workload, but is hard to script serially in a normal Python-based D-test. The nemeses do things like bring down the nodes, drop the disks, inject that latency into the network, and cause the failures that then show up when our actual Jepsen tests occur as bugs, where we'll ACK writes, and then it won't show up in reads later. And then the checker is a really novel system, and so these do post hoc analysis of test results. So while your Jepsen test is running, every single interaction with the database is logging to a history, and then the test ends once it's done. It doesn't have a pass-fail state. And then the checkers go back and do post hoc analysis of that history. So that history might say, at timestamp 1, I inserted this row. At timestamp 2, I did a read. This is what I got. That read has no judgments about what the correct data should be. It's only telling you what you got. And that's because these reads are simulating multiple clients, which are connecting to different nodes. And it's checking that the checker is going to come in later and go, hey, I have a read here at timestamp 5, and it should have the data that was ACK'd earlier, and it doesn't. I'm going to fail the test now. And so those checkers are what's determining a test's failure or success. The interesting thing here is we can write new checkers to do new post hoc analysis without rerunning our tests. So in order to generate new history, obviously you need to rerun tests. But I can say, hey, I have a new way to look at lightweight transactions, and all I need to know is the list of transactions I'd run in my last test, so I can write a new checker, and I can go and find bugs, and I can say, hey, this bug showed up 2 months ago, and I just wrote the checker today, and I didn't have to rerun and, you know, and bisect 2 months of Cassandra commits. I can just look at the test results for the last 2 months. So Jepsen has been fantastic. It's been helping us catch a lot of bugs. So I'm also here. Yes?
Do you always get the same test results? No.
Oh.
In other words, are the results predictable?
Yeah. So the oh, Sam, that killed my mic. So the test results. Okay, so the question was, are the test results predictable? And that is a good point. Absolutely not. So the other main feature of Jepsen tests is these are completely non-deterministic. So you give it a set of instructions on things it can do, and it's just going to do those things. Asynchronously, it's going to simulate many clients all doing the list of things you taught it can do and are legal to do, and it's going to do them in random orders at random times. They're all happening in parallel. So that's why this isn't perfect for perhaps a, you know, CI environment on commit, because we're not going to have the same results every single time, and we might have a bug, you know, that only shows up in every couple Jepsen tests because we're doing things differently in each one. But the power of being able to compose like that, where we can say, oh, here's a new thing that you can do to the system, Jepsen, and it will just start adding those to the tests without you needing to script in where it does them and how it does them in what order. So I'm also here to talk about fallout. So sticking with the music pun of Jepsen being named after Carly Rae Jepsen, Fallout is named after Fallout Boy. Now that's a terrible name, but they first wanted to call it Bieber, and I threatened to quit, so I hope you can understand that this was our best option. So Jepsen is very useful for testing distributed systems in general, but we wanted to focus on Cassandra in particular. In addition, Clojure is a fantastic functional language, but it's not something that many of our developers have experience with. So we built a Jepsen as a service. This is Fallout. It's written in Java. It's written using DropWizard, which is a Java framework for building a website. And so we have a HTTP GUI and a programmatic API from which you can trigger Jepsen tests without ever knowing the architecture of Jepsen and without ever writing a single line of Clojure. So that's going to allow us internally at DataStax, this is a closed source tool that we use to test open source Cassandra and file bugs to the open source Jira, it's going to allow us internally for our Python-based test engineers. Most of our test engineering department are, you know, primarily write in Python, to not need to know Clojure. It's going to allow perhaps our sales solution architects and solution engineers who want to test situations for customers to spin up Jepsen tests without needing to necessarily do much coding. So what do our more detailed technical details look like? So we have our provisioner, and that's going to map over to the OS. So the provisioner provisions host. So it's going to spin up nodes in EC2, on GCE, on OpenStack, maybe through CCM locally on your machine. It's going to use something like Ironic to grab bare metal instances, and it's going to, you know, do the same thing the OS did. It'll spin up your Docker container. It'll image your virtual machine. It will give you the machines that Cassandra is going to run on. And that's a pluggable architecture, so it's, you know, tomorrow we could add a new provisioner that sets up nodes on Azure. But right now, you know, we're doing our testing at GCE. We have a configuration manager, and that's going to map over to the DB. That's instructing Jepsen on the same thing the DB did. It's how to configure your Cassandra cluster. So adding more tokens perhaps per node, or making it multi-DC, or setting up the racks in a certain way, or choosing snitches, as well as doing the actual starting and stopping of all the nodes. We have our providers. These sort of map over to the client. This does something like install Cassandra stress on a node so that you can read and write to the cluster like that. And then we have modules and checkers. So checkers are going to map verbatim over to Jepsen's checkers. They work in the same way. They do that same post-hoc analysis. That's something very powerful, so we just wanted to capture that the same way it was originally. Modules map to both the conductors and the nemeses. So these are completely isolated blocks of code that at no point need to know what other modules are running in your test. They don't need to know when you're running them. And what they do is each one, it's just a Java function, and you're going to tell it a thing it can do to the cluster. You can have a write lots of data module. You can have a run repair, a bootstrap, an upgrade. Any sort of operation you want to do to a Cassandra node or a Cassandra cluster is possible here. And then within a fallout test, you have the option to chain modules in whatever order you like. So these can run in any level of parallelism. So you can run five modules at once. You can run them serially. You can say, hey, I want to first do a big load and then stress the cluster while I'm bootstrapping. And then when that's done, maybe do a repair and a bunch of reads. Anything? Yes, Rob.
You seem to be describing something that has different serializability characteristics than the underlying Jepsen. Am I misunderstanding that?
Yeah, we can go just as parallel as Jepsen does, but I'm not as familiar with Jepsen here, but I believe we can do more fine-tuned control of doing things in a specific order and then perhaps doing certain steps in parallel. And so this, again, is going to give us test composability. So you can have an existing test, and you can go, wow, I wonder how that works if a node is down, and you just add the module that drops a node at that time. And so once all of these modules are written, it's completely trivial for you to compose them into a test without needing to rewrite any code. So what did that get us from our list? Everything. So a fallout test it's a very pluggable architecture because we knew it needed to solve all of those problems. So you can take the same test and edit one line and say, hey, do that with 1,000 nodes instead of 3. Or in that first step where we bulk loaded, put in 30 terabytes of data per node instead of 10 gigabytes. It's going to let us, if I jump all the way back, it's going to let us induce those arbitrary failure cases, do more manipulation of nodes, because these are genuine clusters, not like what we had in D-tests, which are simply multiple nodes on one machine. It's going to let us do that kind of advanced real-time checking that Jepsen does, where we can ensure the state of the cluster was valid throughout the entire time. And now, so I'm just going to walk through some screenshots of what fallout looks like. So here we have my homepage. These are all tests I wrote for Cassandra 7019. So you just have a list of tests. Within a test, we have YAML configuration files. So here, I'm testing one node as my server. So that's my Cassandra cluster using an EC2 C3.4x large. I'm installing this SHA for testing. That was what would become the Cassandra 7019 patch. You can queue off any number of test runs. They're just going to get test IDs. And when you're finished, we're going to dump dozens and dozens of files on you. So absolutely anything that could have or should have been logged during the lifetime of that test has been logged. You're going to get the Jepsen log. You're going to get Fallout's log. You're going to get logs from each of those Cassandra nodes. You're going to get the logs of every software such as stress you ran. Yes?
So it's not a substitute for Jepsen. It's running Jepsen.
Yes. So it has wrapped Jepsen. Yeah. So because Jepsen is a closure library, so that's a JVM. So we're simply just doing the JVM interop down to Jepsen. So one doesn't need to be able to write closure or even write Java to kick off these tests. And then so having all these logs is going to let us do that post hoc analysis and let an engineer go through and see at a very fine-grained detail level what happened when and what went wrong. And it has allowed us to catch a lot of bugs. If you go on the Apache Jira and you search for the label fallout, you'll see all of the tickets we've opened as a result of this work. So that's all I had. Are there any more questions?
Since these are non-deterministic tests,
yeah.
Does that mean there's a certain time duration you have to run these things to make sure you get coverage?
So right now we're running these on an ad hoc basis to do exploratory testing. So these aren't in CI yet, but it's a system where a large ticket comes in and we want to run big tests on it. So These can run as quick as 5 minutes, if you tune down the number of nodes or the number of data being written, and we have tests that have run for over a week.
I guess I'm still not understanding how, if the underlying system is non-deterministic and you're wrapping a non-deterministic system, that you have different serializability in the wrapper. How do the checker logs account for the different serializability context?
So the question was, sort of to reiterate Rev's question, if we're wrapping Jepsen, how are we able to do certain things differently, specifically change the way modules run asynchronously? And it's my understanding that we are triggering that Jepsen API, which is like the actual run test, which kicks off all its generators, simply in serial for each one of our phases. And then for a given phase where we're doing things in parallel, we trigger it with multiple generators. And then those logs are just appended for the checker, because the checkers just care about timestamps and what happened when, and it's just comparing states across time.
Okay, that makes sense. Thanks.
Did you say that Fallout is closed source?
Yes, it's currently closed source.
Any plans to open source it?
I do not believe we have plans at this time to open source it, but the work, all of the work being done with it is currently resulting in bugs and patches to Apache Cassandra.
So I have a very basic question. I'm new to Cassandra. So is it in-memory Cassandra, or do we need to install the real instance of the Cassandra?
So this does the work of installing actual open source Apache Cassandra. So it's the same way one would install it in a real production cluster.
Okay, and does it allow you to edit the Cassandra YAML file? Because I'm looking to how to test the SSL with Cassandra.
Yes.
Okay, yeah, all right, thanks.
Sam, we have one up here.
Hi, so you put up a big list of the possible failures that could be investigated using this. I'm wondering if you are going through those categories to try to generate scenarios that would test those various failure scenarios.
Yes, there is certainly on the open source. So the question was, we had a long list of things that aren't covered by unit tests and D tests, and what is our game plan for tackling those? So internally right now, we're looking for Fallout as a tool to prove stability of Cassandra. So our main goals are hitting density and duration right now. So when a new ticket comes in that's going to go on trunk, we want to ensure that that's going to work on a 500 node cluster over the course of weeks, which is not something that happens except when those patches perhaps are donated by large companies who did that testing themselves. Any further questions? All right, thank you.